Are you worried that nobody's taking the UFOs seriously?
I'm not taking it seriously.
I do like going on social media and then like a totally unrelated posts like, you know, check out this video of this baboon that almost got caught by this leopard. And I'm just like, well, they're not wearing masks.
This is What a Joke
with Tom Papa and Fortune Feimster
on Netflix as a joke radio.
So tell us about your show, David. You're here to talk about Dad Stop Embarrassing Me that's streaming on Netflix right now, and you are smoking weed and you're with Jamie Foxx. Are you a weed smoker? Is that your thing now?
I don't smoke anything. I smoke occasional cigars, but like my dad passed away from cancer, and I bring it up because I didn't really believe in marijuana as a medicinal.
Uh-huh.
He used it therapeutically, and my brother and I came down. And by the way, my dad was a physician. He's a psychiatrist. And so that's why I believed him. And he goes, look, what's wrong with you? And he just went head to toe. Here, put some weed on. All right, next joint. Well, is it your shoulder? All right, rub this stuff. And it really worked, so I don't feel proud, but we stole all of his marijuana product, you know.
Wow, that's cold.
Well, we sent him off to, you know, the next lab.
He would have wanted you to have it.
He really would have. I know my father. He would have. Not other members of my family. They would have been like, what? Why didn't you put it in the casket? Me.
And your character is getting high in front of the family.
Yeah, I never. He is. So I was doing this play before the pandemic, and I get a text. It was my stand-up agent. He said, would you be open for a conversation with Jamie? And I was like, oh, this is it. Okay.
Yeah.
You hit me with it, man, because it's going to be like Django 2. I'm getting an award. I know that much.
Are we playing Ray again?
You know what I mean? It's going to be like two grizzled like police sergeants or something like that. I mean, it's going to be hardcore. And he said, man, listen, bro, I want to do a show. And I was like, first, I was kind of disappointed. Oh, TV. Okay. Well. Then he said, I want to do this sitcom. And I was like, out where I was like, that's great. When your voice goes way high.
All right. Yeah. That'll be cool.
right. But then we talked about it and he just jumped me into the game. You know, Jamie, he was so gracious. And he said, I need you on this show. And I never, you know, Usually the conversation has been, do you read script? Okay, somebody fell out. I think we'll be hitting there. You know that.
Are you available tomorrow? You got to be ready tomorrow.
Nobody ever said, I need you in this project.
Wow.
And I was in, man. I mean, because my main thing really was I wanted to make sure Jamie was in the show. I didn't want to be in there like Robert De Niro presents David Alan Grier in an elevator. You know, I like the pilot episode. Robert De Niro goes, well, this is my floor. wait.
Do you want some ice cream?
Hey, that's mine now. I got the munchies in the Uber when the driver refused to stop at the DQ. Now, how hard is it to make a U-turn on I-75?
You know, Pops, I'm surprised you even know what Uber is.
Oh, no, he doesn't. He just gets in people's cars and yells at them to take him home.
Well, it's all very confusing. I don't know why they call it Uber Pool anyway. Ain't no water in it. I rode for 45 minutes in a Speedo. My ass was itching.
Now, let me backtrack. Yeah. It's a pandemic. Everybody's going through the same thing. We shot this last summer. So I was like, yeah, but I hadn't really been out of the house. You know, at that point, July, that was heavy.
Yeah, that was early.
Uh-huh. Like talking to your gardener, like, just the leaves over there. Yeah. I see him. Stay there. You know, I didn't know how it would even proceed, how we would work. And Netflix sent this, you know, protocol, this whole like 14-page. So they just made it easy. And after we did like a couple of, like a week or so, then everybody kind of relaxed.
Right.
But the great thing about COVID and the pandemic is if you're having a day or a mood, I'll put two masks on and my shield and goggles. Then people went,
and no one will mess with you.
It felt great for me to do the show because, for one, it was just like, oh, I see a way forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. But it's a multicam vibe to it. Like, it's, was there, were you longing for an audience to be there? Was it?
I always would like an audience, but that just was not, there's no way you could do that.
No way. Yeah.
What I did like is Jamie and I and everyone else, we'd be working, and if we could find a sweet spot, we'd just stick there. Oh, do that thing you just did, you know,
put that in.
And so we could just hit it and quit it. There was not a lot of wasted time, because, you know, I do love an audience, but then you have the warm up. Come on, guys. Who wants a candy bar? Been here 7 hours. Come on.
Everyone's milking the laughs.
Oh, yeah. The last show I did with an audience, there are people that come like it's Star Search. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. They're like waiting to sing their song or something. Anyway, what I'm saying is a lot less wasted time.
Right. And it's cool with two comedians and you know each other, like, you know what's funny. It's not like you're relying on people that aren't funny.
Well, you know, Bentley Evans is a guy I've known longer than Jamie. Okay. Jamie and I have known each other over 30 years.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is these are people I really trusted.
Yeah.
If you're surrounded by people you don't know, they could be the best in the world. Then there's a time period where, can I trust this person?
Right.
And do you trust their artistic judgment of you, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
When you put your glasses on upside down.
Oh, no.
There's nothing funnier.
Why have you never done this before? And inside you're like, because no one allowed me to. Because it wasn't funny, yeah.
We got to figure out how to stop this, but without her knowing. What you want to do, Brian? I got Carol Baskin's number. We will never see this fool again. No, Pops. You know what we need? We need the duct tape and the chicken wire. What? No, we're just gonna go to the kid's house and scare him away. Pops, you know what to do.
I have a very particular set of skills. Skills I've developed over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like Brody.
You're so talented, you're so funny, and to be able to go like do New York theater, that still is such a cool thing.
I love it. I love it. It's my first job. It's what I train to do.
Yeah.
I feel like comedy, stand-up comedy, is like my dessert. You know, I would do it for fun because a lot of my friends were stand-ups, and then they kind of blackmailed me into doing it.
Right.
Damon and those guys were like, you can't hang out with us unless you do comedy, because I would do it every night. I would hang out with them. We go from club to club. Oh, yeah. But when I got on In Living Color, a lot of, you know, Damon, I think, was, he didn't really want to tour anymore because he and Jim Carrey had done so much road work. They're trying to stay home.
Yeah.
So my agent was like, dude, there's like 15 new universities they want you. And I was like, really?
Yeah.
So I go to Damon, I go, I'm a trained actor, okay? You play in bars and saloons. He told me how much money he made in one weekend. Literally 48 hours later, I was like, hey, DC, what's up?
I'm a trained actor. Who's ready for some stand-up?
Who are the old Jake Joe? Woo! You know, I was no remorse.